I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. You know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. You know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to praise. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. You know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. You know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord. Good evening. Hope everybody's doing well. The allergies have kicked in on me. I feel like I've got cotton in my throat and everything else. But tonight, glad everybody's here for tonight and for tonight's Bible study together here at the garage. We want to say hello to folks that are watching on Facebook and YouTube. And if you are, you can tell us where you're watching from, and we'll give a shout out to you. And share this with other folks, and that way they can join in with us tonight as well during our Bible study. And if not now, they can join back a little bit later. And so we're glad that everybody's here, and we're going to get ready to get kicked right into this study time tonight. Before we get started, James, would you mind leading us in a word of prayer, please?
Sure. Well, please bow. Dear gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for another day to grow closer to you, to learn more about you. Thank you for all the things that we have in our lives. I know some of them we don't even realize that we take most of it for granted, but we just thank you for all that you do for us. Please help us to take what Jerry says, apply it to our lives, apply it to our knowledge of you, so that one day we can be up in heaven with you. And it's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right. So, Matthew chapter 1. I saw some eyes perk up when I said that. Matthew chapter 1. The question would be, does anybody ever read Matthew chapter 1? Not, did you say not if you could help it?
Not by choice.
Not by choice. Why do you not read Matthew chapter 1? It's difficult. Okay, that's interesting. The words are hard. And maybe it's just the names that are hard. I don't know how difficult it could be. But when we look at Matthew chapter 1, it's got that wonderful, it's according to what you're reading. If you're reading from the King James, it says, begat, begat, begat. And if I could just encourage you for a moment, we're going to discuss a little bit this. I want you to think about this for a moment as if you are looking through your family, you're looking through your family history. So, Logan, let's pick on you a little bit tonight. I'm good at that. So we're gonna, your mother, her maiden name was
Jones.
Jones. She was a Jones, not kin to the Smiths, but she was a Jones. All right. So your grandparents on her side were Joneses.
Yes, sir.
All right. So you got Jones. Did you know your great grandparents?
Yes, sir.
On the Jones side. Yes. Did you know the Jones side, or did you know your grandmothers, or both?
Both.
Both. Oh, okay. But they were Joneses, and what were they?
Dunlap.
Mm-hmm. All right, then you have, but now beyond the Dunlaps and beyond the Joneses, do you know anything? You don't know anything about them. Wouldn't it be kind of neat if you did? Yeah. So in my office in there that you can't get into because it's packed full of junk right now, is a book, and it's on the Bittle family, B-I-T-T-L-E. That's my mom's side of the family. And so I started, you know, you look at my grandfather's name was U period G period Bittle. Yeah, he did not have a name. He had initials for his name. Somebody eventually gave him the name U, but that was his name, U period G period. What's your name? Eugene. And then he said, Eugene. Somebody come up with Eugene. That's what his name was. But I knew nothing about my grandfather's family until they started doing this type of research here. And so they, his mama was a Smith. So not to be confused with the Joneses, but she was a Smith. All right. And of course, my grandfather, my great grandfather, Biddle, died when my grandfather was only 4 years old. So my mom didn't even remember him. How you doing tonight, Daniel? Good to see you. So my mom did her what would have been her granddaddy Biddle. But my great grandmother, who was a Smith, she married someone that was last name of Jacks. And so, yeah, am I starting to get confusing to you yet?
Yeah.
Yeah, good. Well, the cool thing about it was the other day I was looking at an ancestry thing with my family, and I found a picture of my grandfather's mother, who was a Smith, and there were 13 brothers and sisters. That was pretty cool. And then I started looking at all these brothers and sisters that would have been my great. I'm kin to everybody in Munford, Alabama because of them 11 people, just about it. Now that's not true, but that seems the way it is. When you start looking at Matthew 1, you're looking at genealogy. And I know you may think this is going to be the most boringest thing that is. I'm trying to make it a little bit easier for you, where you can might understand something. There's going to be some names in here you understand. In fact, y'all help me out here. I like people. Someone says it's hard names. So here we go. The book of the genealogy of who? All right, Jesus Christ. This is going to be his genealogy. The son of Abraham. Y'all recognize those names?
Yeah.
Okay, Jesus is kin to David, and Jesus is kin to Abraham. All right, there you go. Right there, you got it all the way back here. But how? How is he kin to it? All right, someone read verse 2 for me.
Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Judah, and his brother.
That's easy enough. And you recognized every one of those names just now, didn't you? Yes, and it makes sense. Well, I knew Abraham is the father of Jacob. Jacob had Isaac and Judah. Yes, there's that relationship. Now, there are people that, and they would have told you how many great, 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 greats it would have been, all right? I don't really care about the great, great, greats. I care about Jesus being kin to these people. That's what I care about. I don't. You know, and people that want to do statistics and math and stuff like that, if you're that type of person, there's your challenge for the week. Look and see how many greats it is, and Google doesn't count. All right. So, but then you have Judah and his brothers. Now then, we're going to continue on with the genealogy. Somebody read verse 3 for me.
Judah begot Perez, and Perez begot Hezron.
All right, Judah had a child. His name was Perez. And Zerah, Tamar. All right, that's the mom. That was by Tamar. Boaz had children, a child named Hezron, and then Ram, however you want to say it. Ram had, it's in the Old Testament. It's there. One of these people comes, Ram has Amminadab. All right. Verse 4 says, had Nashon. And Nashon had, I did that to you guys. His name, S-A-L, I don't know if it's Salmon or Solomon. It's not Solomon. But, so here's, this is just the genealogy. All right, now then, we get in here to Solomon. And Solomon, and verse 5, somebody read verse 5 for me now.
Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed, the father of Jesse.
Okay, now then we start getting back into recognizable names, more recognizable names. All right? You get the very first thing when it says, he says, Solomon had Boaz. We know Boaz from the book of Ruth. Thank you. Yes, the book of Ruth. But not only do we get that in there, we get, and Boaz has Obed and by Ruth, all right? And Ruth has Jesse. Well, let me back up. Solomon has Boaz by, who is Boaz's mama? Oh, wait a minute. What was Rahab? A little louder, please. She was a prostitute. That's right. She was a prostitute. She was a harlot. That's what she was. You mean in this lineage of the Messiah, there's an individual that was a sinner? Yes. Yes. And they're not the only ones. The only one. Jesus doesn't come from a perfect genealogy. Jesus comes perfect from God the Father. That's where he comes from. And so we've got that genealogy that comes in. We're going to keep going. I promise you we're going to get through this. All right. Then you get Solomon. Well, I'm back up. Jesse has David, the king. By the way, David was known as a man after God's own heart, right? But what else was David? A what? He was a murderer. Oh, yeah. Who's the man he killed? Uriah. He killed Uriah because of the sin with Bathsheba. So, again, I go in this and, you know, somebody's going to say to you, they're going to go, well, look, you look at that lineage there. There are a whole bunch of horrible, bad people. You know what? Yeah. But everything among these people that we read so far, all right, they bring on to the lineage of Jesus. But every one of these individuals end up being good for God and doing the right things for God. You look at Rahab. She the thing with the spies where she saved the spies from being killed in Jericho. God spared her when they trounced down on Jericho. God saved her. And because of that, Jesus comes through that. David. Man after God's own heart fails miserably because what he does is he goes out and has this sin with Bathsheba, and then they, you know, David is brought down to his knees because of God. And then you got those beautiful prayers that were of repentance and redemption found in Psalm 51. And then, you know, God, he brings himself back to God. Then you get Solomon in verse 6. David, the king, had Solomon, who had been by the wife of Uriah. So there you go. Bathsheba was Solomon's mom, and though that lineage continues on. Again, part of this. Solomon has Rehoboam. Rehoboam has Abijah. Abijah has Asa. Asa was the father of Jehoshaphat, or if you want to remember, Josaphat. And Jehoshaphat had Joram. Joram has Uzziah. Uzziah has Jotham. Jotham has Ahaz. Ahaz has Hezekiah. Hezekiah has Manasseh. Manasseh has Amnon. And Josiah. Where do you know Josiah from? Where do you remember Josiah from? He was 8 years old and became king. He was 8 years old and became king and actually restored the reading of the scripture to the people, because he actually found that. And whoever said 8 year-olds couldn't do anything should have met Josiah. Josiah has Jeconiah and his brothers about the time that they were carried away to Babylon. That's according to captivity. And after they were brought to Babylon, Jeconiah has Shealtiel. Shealtiel has Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel has Abiud, has Eliakim. Eliakim has Azor. Azor is the father of Zadok. Zadok is the father of Achim, and Achim has Eliud. Eliud has Eleazar, and Eleazar has Mathan. Mathan then has Jacob, and Jacob has Joseph, the husband of Mary. So, all right, whose lineage are we reading right here? It's Jesus' lineage, but through who? His dad. This is his earthly parents, okay? This is the lineage, all right? So now you got it. That's where this genealogy comes in from. So what does this genealogy have to do with what I want to talk about tonight? It has everything to talk about. Without this genealogy, there is no Jesus. Now, someone says now, well, wait a minute, God's his father. You're absolutely correct. God is the father and Mary is the mother. But it is this genealogy that rolls down through Joseph that shows importance of the lineage from what God had planned. And the cool thing about it, they were just people just like you and me. Yes, some were kings, some were ordinary people, some were prostitutes. Not so good. But in the end, all of these individuals turned their lives over to the Lord. They're living for the Lord. That's God at this time. And then Joseph, he becomes the father of the Messiah, the earthly father of the Messiah. And that's one thing you need to just kind of keep keyed up there. The generations from Abraham to David, 14. And from David to captivity in Babylon, 14 generations. And from captivity in Babylon until the time of Christ, guess how many? 14. So you got three 14s there, which is 42. Thank you. 42 for those people that like the statistic. There it is. There's the people that likes that stuff. Now, what I want to do for a little bit is I want to talk to you about something that I think is very important. Ancestry is important. Ancestry is very important. What your mom and dad do, what your grandparents do, your great-grandparents. My mom became a Christian. And she became a Christian actually before my grandfather did. But I, mom's faith, her belief. And so I would ask my mom, where do you read this from? Where do you get this from? And she'd say, son, it comes from the Word of God. So I had all reason in the world to believe the things that my mom was teaching me. As a small child. By the way, that's how you learn. When you're little, you listen to your moms and dad, and what do? You believe them, right? You know, your dad might tell you that, you know, I caught a fish one time that weighed 97 pounds. You know, he was this big. I fought him all day long, called him Moby Dick. And so, you know, that's, you know, you listen to him. People will tell you today that you should not have the faith of your mother and your father. I understand that statement, okay? But I don't agree with that statement. Because you see, Paul wrote, and he said this. He says, there's one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, okay? So if my parents and your parents are obeying, doing what the will of God, what the word of God says, all right? Are we agreeing on the same thing? Yes, we're agreeing on the same thing. And then I kind of go back and I'm like, when someone makes the statement that you need to establish your own faith, I get that. Your faith has to become your own. When you become a Christian, that means you're kind of saying, I'm taking on my own faith. But it doesn't mean your parents' faith is wrong. In fact, what it should do, it should, if they are doing what the Word of God says, if they are doing that, it should solidify your faith even more. Because you're thinking and you're believing the same things. It's important. Important for you to understand that. I think it's very biblical. At the very beginning of this genealogy, he starts talking about Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. All right? What was passed down from those individuals? I mean, Abraham was told by God in the very beginning that, you know, wherever your foot's planted is going to be yours. That's what God tells Abraham. Your nations will be as big as the numbers of the stars in the sky. And it continued on, and it continued on. And you did get the Isaac and the Jacobs and the Davids and the Solomons. You got all of this continuing on. But the faith, the belief, stayed the same. So people will say, well, I don't want to believe like the old people do. You got to be careful how you make a statement like that. Really got to be careful. Again, it goes back, because if older people are doing the will of God, they're right. And if you're doing the will of God, you're right. It's not a different faith. It's the same faith. It's all in how you receive it, how you work it, how you make it happen. Now, this is probably going a little bit deeper than what I intended tonight, but I'm going to go there again. I go back to the passage where he says, it's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. All right? That's important for you to understand. If there is one faith, is there any other faith? No, there's not. If there's only one belief. But do we live in a world with multiple beliefs? Absolutely. Absolutely. And then the question, which one is the right one? Which one is the right one? Anybody want to answer that for me? Jesus answers it when he says, he who does the will of my Father. Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. All right? So your faith grows in this. And by the way, your faith is going to continuously grow the older you get. Could it become stale and stagnant? Absolutely. But you know the only way it becomes stale and stagnant? If you allow that to. But you should all come in with a deeper love, a deeper, you know, a deeper relationship with Jesus, with God. When you start doing that, then your faith begins to grow. Are y'all getting wet back here yet? Y'all, let me know.
I'll let you hear it coming.
Well, we'll let the door down if we need to. But right now, we're going to leave it open because we need air. So, all right. But maintaining that faith. But here's what I want. Now, follow with me here. Follow with me here for a second and see. Lucas, it's 10 years down the road from now. You're 38 years old. You're 28 years old. You have your first child. You have your first child. And that first child is now 5 years old. You've had it at 23, and now he's 28. And I'm just saying, that happens in life. That happens in life. You're at 23, you have a child, you're now 28. Your child is 5 years old. What do you want your child to believe about God? What do you want your child to believe about God?
That they're created by God, that they're loved by God, and that they are called to follow and run after God.
Where are they going to learn that from? They're going to learn it from who? From you. But you're not right. Huh? Well, but what if you are right and they're sitting there and they're going, what if you are right? You already said they learn it from where? The word? They learn it from, you're learning it from the word as a father, and that matter, you've learned this from the world. Your word, your faith is strong and your belief is in this, but now this child is like, even at 5 years old. Your child is going to argue with you at 5 years old. I'm going to curse. But I mean, but they're going to be learning it from you. Do you want them to have your faith? Now, when I say faith, just translate that to belief. Yeah. Because you see, you want your children to be taught right, just like you want to be taught the things that are right and to do the things that are right. That's what the Word of God is there for. It makes us sharper in our life. It builds our faith, the belief in God. And that's, you know, and that's that interchangeable word of faith and belief, okay? It's important. It's important for you. There's only one. And we even know what the greatest command is out of it. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Goes back and it tells you how to do that to your children. Deuteronomy 6 tells you to, when you teach it to your children, you put it on their foreheads, you put it all around, you make sure they're always around it. And I think, I may be wrong, I don't think I am in this one. I believe if more parents were talking to you about faith, they were talking to you about your strength and your growth in the Lord, you become even stronger than you are right now. And you're strong. You guys are strong. But imagine. But when I start looking at lukewarm people, like the Laodiceans in Revelation, they're just there. That generation that we read in Matthew is rich. It's with rich people. I'm not talking about financially. I'm talking about faithfully rich individuals. Go back and reread your story in Joshua about Rahab. Go back and reread that one time. We'll take you, but when you get to it, and it takes you about 5 minutes to even read it in there. Story about her, and you see her zeal her love for God in the depths of this, in the midst of this city that wants to rebel against God. And you see her love, and then you see the spies that go, whoa, wait a minute. This woman really loves God. When you start seeing that occur, then you see how faith grows. You see David, who is, again, that man that was after God's own heart. He was there in all of this. And all of a sudden, he plummets in with the sin. And I mean, that sin was bad. No different than anybody else's sin, by the way. No different. But it was bad. It was a bad sin. But yet Solomon comes out of it. And what was Solomon? The wisest. Builds this temple. I mean, this. So out of some really raunchy things, comes some really good things. What does that mean? Means this. Romans 3:23 tells you and me that we've all sinned, come short. We've all had some raunchy, bad things happen in our life. Every one of us. And you know what? It hits our faith, our belief. It hits us. It ties it with Jesus. Our relationship with God, it hits us. But now, doesn't mean it's the end of the world. Because there's something called Jesus, who is at the end of this chapter, or at the end of the section. He's the one that this lineage comes to. And he's known as the Messiah. The Messiah. There ain't no ifs, ands, or buts about it. He is the Messiah. I was in Israel, and I was at the Wailing Wall. They're praying. Some of you have heard this before, but we were praying, and I noticed this young, not much older than you guys, maybe same age as some of you. He's there, and you got the women's section, you got the men's section. He's at the wall, and he's praying back and forth, and back and forth, and back and forth, and back and forth. And he's in Hebrew, I understood a little bit of it, I didn't understand everything. This young man, tears streaming down his face, tears on his face. And he's praying with so much intent. After it was over with, after he finished praying, you respect people. And he kind of walks away, and I kind of talked to him. And I said, excuse me, you speak English? And he does. He had very good English, by the way. Their second language is English, and they probably speak it better than us. I asked him, I said, I noticed in your prayer that you were just so intent in your prayer. Can you tell me why you pray so diligently? He looked at me and he said this. He said, you're from America. And he says, you have your Messiah. You're right. Jesus is my Messiah, but Jesus lived here. Do you understand? He had not accepted Jesus as the Messiah. He didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah. And so what he does is he comes to that wall, and I don't know how often he comes. He said, I come to this wall and I pray. And I pray for the Lord, Adonai, to forgive me. I pray for the Lord, and I pray every time for him to send the Messiah. Please send the Messiah. We need the Messiah. And you're sitting, I'm sitting here, and I'm wanting to say to him, the Messiah has come. His name is Jesus. Let's sit down and let's talk about this. But this young man's faith in God, the Father, without Jesus, was so strong. And his prayers were so diligent, praying for the Lord
to send the Messiah, Yeshua. He was praying for that. Question. If the Messiah had not come at this time in our life, there's been no Messiah. We're still living in this world, today's world, just like we are, but there is, Jesus has not come and Jesus has not died. What would you pray? What do you think we pray, Lucas? Would we really pray that same prayer? I would hope we would. But what is it that would cause us to pray that prayer? The need for a Messiah. So you got a need for the Messiah that has to be there. And also you faith. The belief that God is going. You see, this young man believes that God is going to send the Messiah. That's what he's saying. Okay, God, I want you to send him. I want you to send him. And again, I'm sitting there going, he's here. There's an empty tomb over there. And I'm wanting to go. I'm really wanting to go to the Acts 2 passage. I really am, which, you know, they're not going to regard that in any way. But I'm like, let me show you an empty tomb. You know, David's, it's like Peter was saying, David's still buried right there. And he points out all these things. That's the only thing that's rolling through my mind. Now, the question, the Messiah has come. How are we in our faith? How are we in our faith, in our prayer life, exemplifying ourselves to God for the thanks of having a Messiah? Well, thank you, Jesus, for doing this. Thank you for doing that. But I'm talking about the intense part of the Lord. You've done this for, he died for you and me. Y'all get that? Y'all get that? Daniel, he died. He had nails driven in him. He had nails. And they beat him to a pulp. That's what they did. For you. And so when I start looking at that concept of what he has done and what he's doing, my faith grows deeper. It gets stronger. Because of Jesus Christ, my faith is stronger. Because, you know, I know he's coming back. I know he's coming back. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. Do I know when he's coming back? Nope. Not like the person in 1988 that wrote the book, 88 Reasons That Jesus Is Coming Back in 1988. He bought that book for a dollar. I bet you he sold a million of them. But when you start looking at the building of our faith, it is the one Lord, the one faith, the one baptism. Is in. And we need to grab hold of that. And we need to, there's only one faith, and it's the one that God has given us through his son. We read about it in the word. We grow closer to it because of the word. That's how. Now, we're going to talk just a little bit more. I'm going longer than that. But we're going to let our TV audience, we're going to let our online, I want to thank them for watching. Let's sing a song out of here, and then we continue on. Oh God, you are my God. I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are God, and I will ever praise you. Seek you in the morning, and I will learn your